Welcome back in the Tech Talk studio here at the NCSC conference. We're here with Oscar Coureau, a security researcher who now works at the KPN Red Team. But he used to be a researcher at the NICEF, which is the Dutch National Institute for Subatomic Physics.
Yes.
If I say it correct. You want to talk with us about industrial control systems, or also the SCADA systems, which stands for Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition. Things that drive pumps and stuff. What do you want to talk about, Oscar?
This is critical infrastructure. And the problem of critical infrastructure is that you need to be ensured that this keeps on working. You need to control bridges, you need to control water systems, you need to control all kinds of industrial control systems. This is essential for everything in daily life. And the problem that we see is that there are hidden systems, systems deployed by engineering teams, but not always controlled and supervised properly with respect to the security. And the daily security means that we see on the internet. For internet systems, we have all kinds of firewalls and VPN networks to ensure that only the right types of people can access this network. With SCADA systems and industrial control systems and any other embedded devices, this is a lot more hidden. It's a lot more subtle. They're hidden in the closet physically.
Could you give some examples of these systems? What do they manage? What do they control?
They could control very simple things, like it could be the embedded devices in your smart meters that we would have soon in our homes. It could be the systems that control the lights in your home because you've installed a new, very modern, smart system to control your environment in your home, control everything from a remote control. This could also be the bigger equivalent for buildings. Think of the heating systems, but also everything that you see outside, the lights, the stopping lights, all the cross points. Think of systems that control the sewage systems.
Okay, so these things control
anything.
Important infrastructure, traffic,
yes.
What about, who controls them?
Sometimes that's up for debate.
Okay,
and
it's not clear who controls them.
Sometimes it could be a bit unclear. Some of the systems are well managed, well controlled, and in confined networks. These networks are protected with all the good security practices that we see today in all kinds of servers and web services and whatever you would do. But there are also a lot of systems just deployed without any security whatsoever. People from the internet could make contact with these devices and take over control without the actual supervisor knowing that this is happening. And this is a bad thing. And the way we are working now is that we have smarter systems, smartphones. We know that there are problems in Android and iOS systems, but This level of understanding the risks of your smartphone hasn't yet evolved into the actual devices that control this environment here.
Okay. One of the topics on this conference today is responsible disclosure.
Yes.
You've experienced one of these responsible disclosures, right? There was one Sluice devices, which was reachable online.
Yeah.
How did you find out that you could actually control the water levels in the small municipality of Veere?
So the case of Veere was very very interesting. There was a mention made by a guy called AntiSec on Twitter. He was into full disclosure to make a very strong statement. And the statement is, everything is online, and when it's online, be assured that you have your security means up to date, or if you don't, just disconnect it. Don't have it online.
Yeah. And he full disclosure means that he put it online.
Everything was
to see.
Yeah. He put in the names of the actual people controlling it, of the supervisor of this facility. He put in all the IP addresses of all the machines that he could find through public information, through scans on Shodan. Also, the RIPE database has some information to enrich all this information, and he put it on Twitter.
Okay.
And people didn't pick up on this. And he mentioned all kinds of other systems as well through his full disclosure method. about all kinds of systems that were online, like online controllable power bars and systems that you could actually disable. And just so these power bars are just hooked up through normal network cabling, and you could switch off a light, a server, a machine, or whatever is connected to this power bar. The thing is, he found all kinds of devices randomly on the internet. And one of these things seemed to be the control systems of sewage systems in Veren and all kinds of other devices controlled by these one and the same SCADA systems, ICS systems.
And what did you do with it?
Well, I was making some phone calls to for responsible disclosure to the CERT teams in the university networks that he found. And I kind of also picked up the phone and think, okay, let's go outside of my comfort zone of the academic area and the networking. Let me just call this guy and tell him that his systems are online, and that people could tamper with the sewage systems and tamper with whatever flooding systems.
Okay, so there's this guy sitting in a small municipality. He gets a phone call. He said, "Hi, I'm Oscar. Your system is vulnerable."
Yeah, I gave him my full name, I gave him my credentials, everything. He had my phone number. He was able to call me back, but he didn't understand what was going on. He didn't understand the systems. He was an engineer for sewage systems. He was an excellent engineer, probably for sewage systems, but he wasn't a computer scientist or a computer engineer or networking engineer. So the things that I told him on the phone didn't really ring back into the problem that he actually had. He didn't grasp the problem. And this is one of the problems that most of the people see with responsible disclosure. If you give a responsible disclosure about some vulnerability on your website, what does the system administrator on the other end of the phone actually understand what you meant by whatever you told him? In this case, I could assume control of these very expensive devices, make them do odd things. I didn't. I kept it to just making the statement, this is the control system, you could take over the control and report it on this responsibly. So this is what I tried to do and research the entire network. And because we had the differences with this guy at the gemeente Veren, I contacted the NCSC to intervene and assist because we weren't getting anywhere.
And then they listened.
Somehow the NCSC was more persuasive to the guy in the municipality of Veren, and things happened, and they explained what the problems was. And this is one of the key features that the NCSC is also performing with respect to responsible disclosure. You can, in a neutral fashion, even though they're from the Ministry of Justice Department and Security, you can tell them what's going on neutrally, and they can assist. This was very helpful.
And the other cases on SCADA you found and wanted to disclose or didn't disclose?
Now, most of the things that I found through all kinds of means, either looking myself or, again, other people doing the full disclosure, catching these full disclosures and trying to contact the actual guy, not just spewing them on Twitter and hope that people react. In this case, some people that I've contacted only privately through direct messages, private email, contact them, look guys, you guys have a problem or you have a customer that has problems. Yeah. And then they could forward this message responsibly and nicely and try to solve the big vulnerability that is there.
Yeah. Okay. SCADA is pretty high on the agenda of this conference. There are many presentations on it. What are your expectations? Do we discern that it's still very vulnerable, or are we here to solve it?
I think the vulnerability of these kinds of embedded devices will always stay. I've seen last year, and I think this will exceed this year as well, is that there's a lot of security mindedness going into the embedded devices that we are deploying.
Okay.
So that's progress. People not hooking up their smart meters or whatever embedded devices on the internet directly is a smart thing to do. People are thinking about these new attack vectors. Although I would say new, they're not new. They're anciently old. Since the beginning of the internet, which is before the 1980s, these kinds of problems already existed, that you could bypass anything that would be called a firewall or just routing and just do smart things to gain access to these devices. even though they are behind a firewall or behind whatever control device. Even then, you could attack these kinds of devices because they are small, they are weak, and they don't have the same defense capabilities as my laptop.
Yeah. So we're working on it. We're not just there.
Yeah, at least this is on the radar. People are making progress. People are also disabling features from certain devices. One of the things, I cannot disclose how this happened, but one of the things that I'm really keen on that this happened because of some security-minded person is that the smart meters were equipped with a power off or kill switch and so on.
Okay.
But what is the case with respect to liability? If a smart meter at home, if there would be a person that would be ill, cannot contact the energy company, and the energy company states, I'm going to switch off because you didn't pay the bill. But this person was very, I don't know, had some kind of illness and is on a heart monitor.
Cardiac.
And you cannot disable this device because that means death.
Yes.
Do you take this type of liability? Now, I'm very keen that through the context that I've seen here, that people have disabled this kind of features and took the right way of not trusting everything that goes in and out of these embedded devices.
Kill the kill switch. Okay, that's right. This conference is all about networking, smart coalitions, a totally different topic. You have a networking event of yourself too.
Yeah.
Operation Cyberpaint.
Operation Cyberpaint.
I have to admit, I was there last year and we could cyberpaint with various groups from police, hackers, government, businesses. Are we going to have a next cyberpaint this year?
Yes, at September 6th on a Saturday, we will again have an Operation Cyberpaint event in New Loosdrecht, in a very keen and convenient location. We will have a panel discussion to discuss all the major topics that fly by, not just here at the NCSC, but also at hacker conferences and what they have to say about certain topics. Mm-hmm. So these are the views that we are mixing. Hackers, anonymous, info security professionals, and people that have ties to the government or are government agents of some sort.
One thing I remind very well from last year is that we split it up in six teams. And there was Deloitte, there was KPMG, there was the police, there was the government. And what you would expect is that a well-organized team would win. But the team that won was the people who didn't fit in any category and were the rest category. What is your theory on that?
Mixing is making it, It's like nature. Nature thrives with respect to how DNA works, right? If you have diversity, diversity is strength.
Yes. Okay, smart coalition indeed. And I have to say the women were second, right? The women in cyber.
Women in cybersecurity were awesome.
Yeah, shoot them up.
Okay. Yeah, we have to shoot them because they're actually quite good.
Too good. Okay, yeah. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you very much. Orsta Kuro.
Thank you.